May 4th, 2016, Select Board meeting in the town of Deerfield, held at 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass. Okay, first item on the agenda is election of chair. Why don't we put that off for just a minute, unless you guys, I don't know what you want to do about it.
I would nominate, can I move to nominate you as chair?
This is kind of awkward, yes.
Yeah, I'd second that. I just want to say that I think Trevor was in the position that it would be his term to do it, but being new, I can certainly understand him wanting to pass over.
And that's fine.
Thank you.
I hopefully will work cooperatively, and the way we work it, or the way I would hope that we would work it, is that whoever wants anything on the agenda, usually it's the chair that's responsible for the agenda.
Okay.
And working with the town administrator, set up an agenda every 2 weeks. But honestly, if anything, anybody wants anything on the agenda, you just let Doug know.
Great.
And I'll decide.
I mean, that's why, no.
Decide.
That's the way we've always done it, and that's, you know, to me, that's important. If there's something that needs to happen, just put it on the agenda.
Sure.
Next item on the agenda is to sign the CALS form, which is, Doug, what did you say it was? It was not the...
CALS stands for Certified, I'm sorry, it stands for Contractor Authorized Signatory Listing. This is a form that we keep on file anytime that we do a state contract. We actually have to send this form out with the state contract copies.
With the Board of Selectmen members?
Correct.
Okay.
With any change of the Board of Selectmen, that has to be done.
All right.
And I'll give you each a copy of the form. We just need literally to have you sign on the X. That's one for you. Nope, that's Kip's. That's yours.
Okay.
While we're doing this, also, if I may, if you sign on the second page, if I may, if I could get you to sign anywhere on this white piece of paper underneath Carolyn's name, we're leaving plenty of white space between her name and yours. Same thing here. What you're signing is...
You did say the second page of this.
Yes, right.
Oh, you know what? I think I did the first page, too. Whose is this? Is that Barbara's?
That would be Barb's, yes. So don't worry about it. We can redo the first page.
Okay.
We just need your signature.
I did sign the second page.
Your signature, Kip and Trevor, is for your signature stamp, which we use to rubber stamp all decisions.
Oh, that's a nice, I don't know what you're talking about. That was a nice signature.
There we go. Perfect. That's perfect. And good?
Yeah. Oh, who's that?
That's me.
Of me.
I have to sign that.
All right.
Here she is.
Perfect.
Okay, thanks, Doug.
Thank you all. That was pro forma, it's just part of business, and helps us out later on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next item on the agenda is Tri-Town Beach and Swim Program.
Should I talk to you here?
No, you know what? You have to come up and sit at the table, and only because, you know what? People are really truly interested.
Okay, great. All right. So I'm Beth Foley. I'm one of the Tri-Town Beach Commissioners. I came on board kind of on the fast track last year. Tri-Town had lost a couple commissioners. They were looking pretty fast, so I jumped on board.
And I want to say thank you.
Yes.
Because that was...
Thank you.
That made it able to operate, so I appreciate that.
Oh, you're welcome. I've got some information. You guys were looking for some information at a previous meeting, and after talking with Doug, we sat down together and tried to gather as much information that we could that you were looking for. So I have some information that I can give you regarding where we're at with Tri-Town Beach and the swim program as well.
Okay.
So the swim program last year had 117 kids participate. 42 of those kids were kids that just came to do swim lessons, and the rest of the kids came with the River Valley Day Camp that comes to the beach for 6 weeks during the program. So it was a total of 117 kids that took the swim lessons. So I think you were looking for that. And then passes for Tri-Town. You were looking for specific towns, how many from each town were using passes. So want me to just tell you what they were?
Sure.
Okay. So for the town of Deerfield, we had 44 people bypasses. Waitley, there was 15. Sunderland, 9. Hatfield was 16. And Conway was 2. So it's a total of about 86 passes that were sold. Out of those 86, 29 were seniors that took advantage of the passes.
Oh, that's really interesting. Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah. 57 were families. So I think the numbers were low, but the beach last year, the weather wasn't great. We had some issues with the water, and we were closed, I think, more than we had anticipated or had in the previous. So the weather didn't cooperate. So unfortunately, we lost some time there. And I think that's, and then as far as how we're running the beach, that's where I'm on the fast track of learning. I know that you guys spoke, I watched the meeting on TV. It looks like we need some guidelines and some more answers for what you guys are looking for. So we're happy to dive in and figure out what that is. If you have specific questions, I'm happy to answer them. I don't know if you know what they are now. I can do my best to answer them.
I think what our concern was, we wanted to make sure that it was being utilized. And obviously, when you reporting to us, that makes us feel better that, you know, we're spending town money for something that is actually getting used. I know myself, my kids learned to swim, at Tri-Town Beach. I had 4 kids, so, you know, it was a very inexpensive way to have my kids have swimming lessons and have, you know, summer place to swim. So, I mean, I felt it was always very valuable, but, you know, times change, and there was some question on, you know, how much use it was actually getting, and, you know, demographics have changed. People are working, and it's a little bit different than, you know, 30 or 40 years ago, so.
And we've done, last year, the flyers went out late to the students. So the flyers are already out. So that's a big, I talked to Jay Yankowski, who runs the swim program, and that was a big thing, that it kind of got out late. So now we were on top of it, so that's out. We've reached out to River Valley. They're coming back as well. They come for 6 weeks. They come 4 days out of the week. It's pretty busy when the kids are there. There's some other organizations we've reached out to see if they want to utilize the beach. So we're waiting to hear back from a couple of them still.
Trevor or Kibby, did you have any questions?
Well, I remember hearing that there was some concern about the money at the beach, you know, how it was collected, what was done with it, what records were kept, you know, in that sort. I mean, do you have any insight to what goes on at the beach?
I did inquire about that. I personally had nothing to, I didn't, that wasn't part of my duty. And Bill Strosky handled that. So the kids have a book, and when people buy passes, they fill out their name, their address. We give them a receipt, and we keep a copy. And then the deposits match, the cash should match that, and then Bill deposits it at once a week. Or a couple times a week, given the take. That particular journal is the only thing, you know, you buy a pass and there isn't much,
right.
Much else. The River Valley, we do a one-time fee for all 6 weeks, and we have that invoice.
Do the towns get sent a copy of this journal or any of that financial information?
Everything gets brought I believe Bill brings everything to the town here.
Okay.
Yeah, and he said it's in a deposit ledger, which I have a copy of. So
that was my only question.
Yeah.
I was seconding that. That was kind of where we were wondering where the money was, you know, how it was getting accounted for, making sure that people had a good record keeping.
I think there was talk about a cash register. Somebody brought up, you know, were we going to buy a cash register? You know, we voted no just because there's not a lot of money and we kind of want to keep it. We're happy to do any, you know, if you have suggestions, you want us to do it a little differently, we're happy to do that. You know, I'm kind of going to dive in there and try to be a little bit more organized and, yeah. You know, for everything. But you know,
it might be really helpful to talk to Barbara, our town clerk, treasurer, collector. She might have some money handling suggestions for you that, you know, are accepted standard or, you know, good practices that would be helpful. And, you know, it just would be helpful for you to have maybe some guidelines that, you could say came from Barbara, or, you know, a statewide accepting of how to handle money.
I
so
would love that.
That, so that it just doesn't seem to be that you are criticizing anybody, or, you know, and that way it might be helpful, and that would be good guidelines because it's general accepted practices. So I'm sure Barbara will have some suggestions, or where you could go on the state website somewhere. Somebody has some information somewhere. And then, and if you use that guideline, then it's not like, oh, you do this. You know, it's just like, let's just introduce some good practices.
Happy to do that.
And that way everybody's off the hook. And
okay.
And then there's no criticism.
Great.
So thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Beth, I really appreciate
you
coming in.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. And thank you for volunteering, because it really is a worthwhile
thing.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is announcements from board members, personal goals, area of focus. Doug put this on, and so I started thinking about it. What we've done over the years is generally split up the workload, and it's on areas of interest. And so I was thinking about it, and this is just an example. I'm not forcing anyone to do it, but, you know, Kippy, I was thinking, you know, we have the school roof coming up this summer, and we're very concerned that, you know, it gets done correctly, obviously, but we want to make sure that it's done in a manner that we have a warranty. And I was hoping maybe you would work with Dick on that to oversee some of the stuff so that the installation is correct. I was just a little nervous on a couple of the contract stuff. I'm sure Dick can explain it to you.
Well, I'd be happy to do that. And I spoke with Dick this afternoon. I spent a couple of hours reviewing the plans, and I was actually quite amazed at how detailed they were for such a simple job. And I will definitely make sure that it gets done according to the plans and the specifications. I still would like to express my concern of the overall design. I think we're still going to have ice problems, but I mean, it seems a little late in the stage to change that. But going forward, it will be done the way it's supposed to be.
Well, I think one of the things I think that we do have to be aware of is because the ice issue, we don't want an ice buildup, because I'm concerned about how close we are on the weight load and stuff. So maybe we can figure out a maintenance program that would, if there's starting to be some ice, we can pull it off, you know, whatever. But that needs to be worked out. But the main thing is we get the installation. It's very on the fast track, and I just was worried that kind of thing. And then I was thinking, you know, we're generating enough money in the CPA fund, so I think we're at a point where we can seriously look at senior center renovations. And I was hoping that maybe you could put something together for the capital committee, because we are actually putting our plans together in the next couple weeks, where we have a meeting, and it just makes sense to put that in. And and then once we get moving on the renovations, we'd have two or three more years to build up the CPA fund again, and then maybe we could move on to senior housing, looking for a private person or a company like Loomis or somebody to work with us to build senior housing, because we've tried to work through the Regional Housing Authority for years. I mean, this was since 1999 I was on this committee, and we've never been able to get senior housing, and so we just got to do it ourselves. But if we use the CPA money for the senior center renovations, we need like 3 or 4 years to build up, so we have some incentive to work with a private individual. So, but anyway, that was just my thoughts. And then we also have the wastewater. We're going to have a wastewater treatment committee, but I was hoping, Kippy, that since you have a lot of background in that stuff, you could review it, because out of the blue, we went from a few million dollars to $30 million. And I kind of, you know, we need 10 pairs of eyes on this to figure out what is needful, how we're going to do it. And again, this is part of our capital plan. What are we actually going to do? So I was hoping that.
Well,
and then,
not to interrupt, but I will over the next week get in touch with Kevin, and I'd like to tour the facilities and talk with the operator as well as Kevin to see what their initial thoughts were of this. And
we have the report.
Great.
that both of you can read.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty well detailed, but, you know, it's just like if you're going to a doctor, you know, you should probably have second or third opinions because it's so much money. But anyway, and then Trevor, and again, I'm not trying to pigeonhole you, but you're coming from the elementary school.
Yep.
So we have a new superintendent coming on board. It was so nice to have Marty Barrett as our superintendent. It was like a breath of fresh air. And I'm just worried that if we don't have a good relationship with this new superintendent, where it becomes adversarial instead of working together.
I don't think that'll
happen. And, you know, you could call Marty and you could talk to her and you could get real answers and you felt comfortable that she was being really upfront with you. Mm-hmm. And she knew we were coming from not anti-education. It was just we needed to, you know, we have limited budget.
Right.
And school, the total school costs, if you add in Smith Volk and, you know, charter schools and all that, it's you know, about 70% of our budget. So,
right.
But they're over a barrel, too. You know,
I know.
The governor gives us $25 and then takes away our regional transportation and then expects us to be happy with our increase. And you know, but the whole idea is to have a relationship that we can work and talk. And so I was kind of hoping
I would love to.
You would work with the new superintendent and we could establish a relationship like we have with Marty now.
Sure.
And
I'm sure that
hopefully the person will be as good as Marty.
Then
we also have coming down the line, I was on this committee, that long-term sustainability committee, but the report is due is going to come out in the next few months. And hopefully they'll have some actionable items and some ways that we can work to try to figure out because what we're doing now, how we're financing our schools, just isn't going to work.
Right.
You know, it's very, very tough every year to come in 2-3% increase. And we certainly can't go back to the double-digit increases in the budget. So some of those suggestions or actionable items, I'm hoping
I'd love to help you
be in charge of, and we could try to move together as a board and organize the other boards as well, because some of this stuff is to do with Frontier. It's not just
towns.
The elementary school. But, you know, there's really exciting things that were coming out of, or I got excited about. It's like, well, if we close one of the elementary schools, say Waitley, we closed and made that, you know, a math science academy. And, you know, it took all the district kids that were interested and you go down there. And so there was like this flow, or you move the sixth grade over to Frontier and then you did some other program. So in other words, you were actually improving the schools and doing all these exciting things instead of just fighting for the status quo, which we couldn't
sustain.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So, I'd love to work with that.
And I'm not trying to freak you out, but there is a lot of stuff. And so I kind of wanted you guys to just think about what you'd be interested in. Usually in June, there has always been a new selectmen's orientation through the Mass Municipal Association.
Yep.
But what was happening is that there's always conflicts. People have personal conflicts in June. It's just a busy month. So they've moved it this past year. They moved it to the fall. So this coming fall is October 29th, and it's at Holy Cross in Worcester. And what it is it's all-day training, and it goes over all your like monetary stuff and legal stuff, human services stuff, all these things that we're responsible for. So it actually is very beneficial. The other MMA, I called and told them that you guys were new selectmen.
Mm-hmm.
So in the next week or two, you should be getting a flash drive with all, and it has all your information, like selectmen's handbook.
Great.
All your resources, some of the stuff you guys are already aware of, but it just gives you an overall view of what's going on. The Mass Taxpayers Association has a new president, Eileen McNanny, I think is her name, something like that. She's circulating around, so maybe we can have her out in Western Mass here and we can have a local meeting, and that's kind of interesting because she gives... they give long-term view of what the prospects are for raising revenue and different different things from a municipal point of view. Okay. It's a little bit, it's like reverse. They give their long-term view, and it's usually not good, but it gives you an idea of what our prospects are down the line.
Okay.
There is a lot of different things that over time, all our appointments are good until June 30th, so there's no...
Okay.
There's no rush to do anything like in the next week, but there's incident command systems, 100 and 200. I think 100 is you can go online. 200, I think you have to take a class. 300 is definitely a class because it's a three-day class. But that shows you in an emergency what kind of, you know, you how you handle an emergency. You fit into different categories and stuff, and it is actually really helpful. But you guys, you know, when you do it on your own time, mm-hmm. you can figure out. There's the Maven. It's the we're also Board of Health, and so Lisa handles most of the Maven stuff. But what that is the automatic all your reportable diseases. Anything that happens in Deerfield gets reported, and we're signed on. And we get those reports.
Okay.
Communicable disease. Lyme disease is like the standard thing.
Sure.
Deerfield residents get Lyme disease. But sometimes it's awful stuff like tuberculosis or, mm-hmm. you know, a neurovirus or something like that. You get that report.
Okay.
There's all kinds of committees, all kinds of stuff. I was trying to think of what Mark was on, but mm-hmm. just I can go over some of the stuff.
Yep.
That I'm on, and I don't. This is only because over time it's sort of my interests, and I got freaked out in 2005 when we were flooded, and I said I would never be in that position again. That was when Mitt Romney was governor, and he was in South Carolina making jokes about Massachusetts, and it was Columbus Day weekend, and we were flooded. We had $4.5 million worth of damage here, and we couldn't get anybody, and. Yeah. I thought, what was wrong? Chris Forgey was in the same place. She had, you know, the trailer park wiped out.
Yes.
We couldn't get anybody.
Right.
And we're like, what the heck happened? So anyway, I have numbers. We're never in that situation again. But from that, I developed sort of an interest in rivers and stuff like that. So some of the committees that I'm on Homeland Security. I'm the municipal rep for Homeland Security. And there's lots of committees, even though I'm a voting member on the council, there's lots of committees you can participate in. I'm on several FERCOG committees. I'm on the executive board, the council. Mm-hmm. But I'm also on the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy Committee and the Economic Development District. I'm on Franklin County Conservation Commission and the State Commission for Soil and Water. And the Mass Association of Conservation Districts and the Mass Watershed Council. And we also have a group of all the towns up and down the Deerfield River up into Vermont, including Vermont. It's a resilience communities group that we're working together to try to fund replacement stuff. We meet on a regular basis since December of 2011 after Irene.
Mm-hmm.
And that's sort of all related to water. From a Homeland Security point of view, I'm on the Planning Committee and Training and Exercise, and I try to get stuff for us as communities. Right now I'm working on a cybersecurity training for town employees. I think that's really important. We have a
Absolutely.
Basic.
Mm-hmm.
All town employees have some kind of training so that they're an awareness of cybersecurity. So we're trying to get that in. Also, I'm trying to do this. Massachusetts has a basic resource officer training, but which most resource officers in all the communities have had. But I'm trying to get a psychological, some kind of training, the next level, so that you can identify kids more readily that are like suicide risks or
sure.
bullying risks or whatever. And so it would just be another level of more advanced training. So you can be on any committee like that. I'm on the Select Board, Executive Board Association, the Select Board Association Executive Board, because I was a past president. And I think for another year or two, I'm on that. And so, but it's interesting to go to the Selectmen's Association meetings because you network with other selectmen, and then you figure out how you work together, or you have problems that are, you know, we're not the only one that has the same issues.
Sure.
I'm co-chair of the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition. That's the Board of Health in Franklin County, and we work together for grants, what's trending, what's, you know, what mosquito issues are happening, whatever. I'm on the Regional Emergency Planning Council committee, which is, it's everybody that's like fire and police mm-hmm. and railroad, and it's just a group of people that we do the hazmat kind of stuff. Mark came in. Mark is on the SCEMS. He did the senior center and the Council of Aging, because the senior center is three towns. The Tilton Library Committee and FCAT. What are some of the other things, Mark? As emergency manager, you of course went to MEMA meetings every month.
REPC.
Yep, REPC.
Regional Emergency Planning Committee.
Yeah. You guys don't have to worry about that too much there at this point. There's a lot of stuff, and you can figure out what you're interested in and then figure out how
we can share the load.
Yeah, and like I said, we're going to always have flooding issues and water issues. And especially after Irene, some of our riparian buffer is like 16 feet less than it was pre-Irene. Yeah. So our roads, like Mill Village Road, is very much more vulnerable than it ever has been. And it will take a much lesser event to cause trouble.
Right.
But the reason why we have this resilient communities group that we work together is because we need $150 million. And we've probably gotten $12 or $14 million in the last couple of years. But when you armor the river, you increase the velocity of the water, and we're at the bottom. So the idea is you start up in Vermont and you work to have everybody work together and coordinate their projects and to make sure that you're actually doing the correct repairs and that you're not actually armoring the river so that we end up with more water and more issues. So it's
right.
It's more work to work together, but in the end, Deerfield ends, we end up better.
Right.
And we have better chance of having money. Money does come in periodically to Kevin to do stuff like the culvert on Mill Village that was repaired by Melnick's. That was some of that was subsidized, you know, that kind of thing. We work with TransCanada. We try to get them to donate to projects and coordinate and be matching funds to, say, another grant. And so one of the reasons that I do all this stuff is because, you know, it's to hustle money.
Right.
Because everything is so expensive and you're trying to do real, you know, repair it once and not keep revisiting the same thing. So if we blow out a culvert, you want to upgrade it so it doesn't blow out the next storm.
Sure.
And
money well spent.
So that's sort of how we've done stuff. But I certainly am not trying to pigeonhole either one of you. I'm just trying to say that you try to complement mm-hmm. what your interests are and what your skills are, and we just try to split the work. The main thing, of course, is just try to read everything and so that we catch things if necessary, and because there's just a lot of stuff to read and go through.
I bet.
So, did you have questions?
Not so far.
Okay. So, I mean, there's no decisions you have to make, and just sort of get an overview and.
Sure.
You know, the next three or four months, some things will come up and just figure out. Are you interested?
Right.
Great. If you're not, that's okay. Somebody will do it.
Right.
Kind of thing. Mark, did you have any comments on? You know, some of the stuff that we were talking about.
No, the only thing I'd like to, the only reason I came in is to offer my guidance or suggestions or anything that you can be helpful to you in
Right.
And if somebody has questions or concerns, I can give what I know.
Right.
I don't want anybody to take what I say as gospel.
Sure.
Because it's the way I interpreted the thought process. But if somebody needs something, any of you need something, I'd like to, if it's something that you guys don't want to cover, I'd gladly stay on some of the boards and stuff that I'm on at this point mm-hmm. in time. So
right.
That's it. I'm not here to make a pitch or to
yep.
disrupt any of this. So anything that you feel fine to, please get me the message. And I'll try to be as available as I can. I've got 2 more months of heavy work before my company downgrades, so it's last time.
Yeah.
The safe store competition, and it looks like I'll be unemployed at that point, so I'll have some time on my hands.
Sure.
Maybe. So that's all I want to make sure everybody realizes. I'm not going anywhere. I'm still going to live in town, and if there's something I can do to help, be helpful, please let me know.
I would love that.
Yeah, there's just there's a meeting on at the FERCOG on the 19th about marijuana. Okay. We have a dispensary opening, so I mean that could be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
We have some background, but it's always helpful to have more information.
Sure.
June 30th is municipal law basics for new board members. The FERCOG is putting together. June 1st is new official finance forum. You can look this up. The easiest thing is to look this up on the FERCOG webpage.
Okay.
And then you can see the description for it and see if you're interested. The Selectmen's Association meets June 16th. I gave you the October 29th. That's the big...
Those are the...
Yeah, the October 29th at Holy Cross is probably the most informative for you guys. So just give you the biggest overview.
Yeah.
The June 21st is the Massachusetts Health Officers meeting. It's an orientation for local board members, and that's June 21st at Tower Hill in Boylston. Tower Hill is a botanical gardens. It's lovely.
Okay. Michelle goes there all the time. I hear about
it.
I know.
I'm actually a member of it. I went there for a Board of Health meeting in December, and it was so beautiful in December. I decided that I would be a member and go down there more often. It's only about an hour away.
Mm-hmm.
And the Department of Public Health has a lot of meetings there because their building is, their central office, central mass office is just down the road.
Okay.
So they use Tower Hill a lot. And once you go there, it's very easy to get there. And
right.
That's a general orientation. And that's really good. Mark, is there anything you can think of offhand for any other orientation things? But the orientation
right.
for the Board of Health and the orientation for the Selectmen would probably be the most and two important things for
mm-hmm.
you to go to, because then you can get an overview.
Right.
And then you can have questions or whatever. I honestly didn't know that I was even Board of Health for the first 6 months. I mean, the first 6 weeks that I was a Selectman. And so, I mean, it was pretty stupid. But I didn't know that when I was elected for Selectman that you're Board of Health. But I have to say it's really great because in an emergency, every emergency has a public health aspect to it.
Sure.
And it is very convenient to be the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Health and make a decision that's best interest of the town.
Right.
And we don't fund public health in a way that is really necessary to have a separate Board of Health. It's always underfunded, so you're always trying to find ways to do stuff for cheap.
Right.
And it's another one of those jobs that, you know, you get excited about because it has huge impact. But,
right.
So I am really, I'm excited about public health, and I always tell people, patrol your yards. After all this rain, we're going to have lots of mosquito breeding areas,
sure.
So I have to get that in today. So anyway, Kibby, do you have anything that you want, or you were interested in or thought about?
Not necessarily of those that you'd mentioned, but I'm going to review them and see what further they go into. I mean, I was more concerned about getting on to other local committees in the town where I could be more beneficial maybe the, I know, I saw in here the wastewater treatment study committee or stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd like to get involved with that and see, you know, what's going on and, you know, how I can help.
Well, I was hoping you could, you'd be interested in that because we're putting together that committee. And like I said, there's huge expenditures coming down the line, and it would just be nice to have a lot of eyes looking at that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to speak prematurely, but I, going back 20 years ago, I mean, there was a similar concern with the wastewater treatment plant. There was a moratorium and stuff like that, and it all, it just turned out to be, you know, whether it was mismanagement or, you know, bad pipes or things like that, it wasn't the big disaster that it was supposed to be. You know, maybe this time is different, but, you know, I don't know anything about it at this point, you know, as far as what's going on, but I definitely would like to look into it.
I think that sounds wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that we were talking about was having a meeting of committee chairs at some point. Periodically, we've done that in the past, and it's been very productive.
Absolutely.
Since you're both new, I think it would be very good to talk to the chairs and any committee members, obviously, that want to come, and just try to get better communication and
absolutely
sort out any questions that they might have and answer your questions of what they actually do and what they're responsible for. And that's always helpful. And it's surprising how many committees we actually have. We have quite a few.
Carol, let me ask you, what's the protocol when this board wants to confer with a particular board? You just ask Doug to contact them and
invite them to a meeting. Yeah. Okay. It has to be posted and it has to be on the agenda and all that. So, yeah, Doug.
A single board member can go to any committee.
Anytime.
At any point. You can approach any committee chair at any point.
Actually, as long as it's not a quorum.
A single board member can approach any committee at any time. Technically, two board members or three board members could attend a committee without violating open meeting law, so long as you don't confer amongst yourselves. So three of you
just
can attend any committee meeting if you wish. But you can personally reach out to any elected or appointed committee chair. Okay. That's the appropriate sort of chain of command for communication.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great.
I didn't want to miss this. This is a small town summit.
Mm-hmm. Correct. They have that in announcements a little bit later on, but yes. Actually, if you look in your section 3 or 4 of your binder, the one you've got.
This one.
Yep, the one with the tabs in it.
Yep. The empty one?
The one on your right, Kip. In that binder there with the tabs. There should be it's in there somewhere. There should be a handout related to the Small Town Summit.
It's not this one here.
No, it's not the big one. It's the smaller one. I was going to talk about those a little bit later.
Oh, there it is.
And under announcements or general information, there's information about a Small Town Summit. It's happening tomorrow evening. We just got notification of this a few days back, but I do want to strongly encourage you to attend if you can. I plan to be there. I don't think this is directly related to the organization or the group of folks that the school superintendent has been meeting with, but I do know that it's along those same lines, wherein small town administrators, members of select boards, and so on and so forth, will be able to meet and discuss concerns that face all small towns, particularly those in Western Massachusetts. And it's certainly a great opportunity to get out and to get your name known and to listen to what other folks have to say. I think you're going to find a lot of commonality in terms of the concerns that other towns are facing.
Doug, were you going to go?
I'm planning on attending.
Okay.
Yeah.
I actually can't go. I have my son coming tomorrow night. I have to stay home and clean the house and then cook.
There's priorities. There you go.
So...
But yes, I do plan to go.
So you plan to go because I'm sure this is going to be like the first of many meetings.
Indeed.
So could you make sure that they know that we're interested and we want to participate as a board? Just not able to, or I'm not able to that tomorrow night. Okay.
Can I say a few words?
Oh, sure.
I would just want to thank Mark Gilmore for his service. And I wanted to thank David Wolfram for his service. And
that's
I'm really excited to be on this board. I'm really excited to learn. I mean, it's a pile of work, I can see. I'd like to share in that load and learn how I can help the town. And I really wanted to thank the people who have served before us for all the work and the many, many years that Mark has done and that David has done and all before to get us where we are. So,
I know. That's absolutely true. Thank you, Mark, too. It's 18 years, right?
It's a long time.
It's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of hours.
I will. Yes. Yep. Right.
Carol's been here a very long time. There's a lot of people that are still around the fact that they don't mind being asked. They don't want to infringe upon
sure.
where you're going and how you're going to do it. And then you run away because human brains are invaluable in how to make things better. So I'm glad you're stepping up and both of you stepping up and taking the reins. Because we use it in a lot of our committees. You know, people, we have seats that are open.
Yep.
Don't be afraid to keep asking for people to show up.
Great.
Find ways that we didn't accomplish getting people excited about helping out and be part of the process.
Right.
So, thank you guys. You're on a very interesting journey and with your all that.
Thank you very much.
That's right. My wife, thank you very much.
Right. We'll take that.
Doug, you had meeting dates. And one of the reasons we weren't going to meet on the 18th was that it was supposed to be the annual meeting for the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition, but I just found out that that was canceled. It's
been
in
canceled.
June. It's going to be in June. It's been postponed. I don't want to say it's canceled. It's postponed.
Okay, so
there's too many conflicts.
Okay, so by sort of moving that meeting from the 18th to the 25th, you have inadvertently committed yourself to meeting on the 25th because we have at least one group of folks from Pink & Company that will be coming out. They will be bringing with them the clerk of the works for the roof project for a first meet and introduction. They'll also be providing an update of the project on that day. So with your permission, I'd like to keep that date.
That's the 25th. Fine. That's fine. As long
plus,
as that's
of course,
okay.
The CIPC meeting is happening earlier that evening anyways. So
is that
there's
okay
that.
With you guys?
But meeting on the 18th is a good thing. And if you want, I can do a dovetail right into that part of the conversation.
Sure.
Okay. Let me just make sure I've got that. Meeting dates, yes. You have in the larger binder, Kip to your left and Trevor on your right. If you take a look at the first section, I think it should be in the first section. There's several things. Two schedules are the warrant schedules and the payroll schedules for FY 2017. Broadly speaking, boards of selectmen, select board meetings, however you want to describe it, meet on the dates of the warrant publication. It's usually every other Wednesday evening. So there's your meeting schedule in that list. There are two separate dates. One is the date that the warrant closes, and about 5 days later, the warrant is available for signature. This is, of course, one of those days. There are a couple of exceptions. Oftentimes, there's a double warrant right around the turn of the fiscal year, but I think those are actually in there as well. The last warrant of FY16 is at the top of that list. So there's that. I did want to remind you of, yes, the meeting on the 25th, which is an off week. The board has the authority to meet whenever you choose. But generally speaking, a meeting every other week has served fairly well. You can choose to continue that if you wish.
So the only thing I wanted to say on that is I still wish to serve on the school committee.
Mm-hmm.
And they meet Wednesday, so tonight they're meeting. But I, you know, this is much more important. Not that it's not important to be there as well, but swearing in is really important. And your first selectman meeting, you don't want to miss. So that was just my only, I mean, they don't meet, I think my last one is in June, and then they don't meet again until, I was just curious if, and I don't want to, I know there's a lot of schedules going on, and I was just hoping to be able to meet.
Is it the first Wednesday? It's
usually the first Wednesday, and I can get, I have the dates all for next year, maybe we could talk at some point about.
We'll change it.
Just to adjust here and there, but.
Yeah, no problem.
Even if it's a date or I could come in earlier.
We've altered the dates according to people's schedule quite a bit, so.
Okay, great.
Over the years, yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
As long as.
Oh, they have before, I see. I do sign warrants, but we could move those. I could always go in to sign them. Yeah.
No, I mean, we did that way so that basically we click the town office.
Okay. That's a good point.
Again, it may not be an issue any longer, but.
And we can sign, can just authorize ourselves to sign the warrant as well.
Okay.
At our convenience, so. Yeah.
Is it one school committee meeting a month?
Yes.
Okay, maybe the thing to do would be to determine just how many of those
conflict
with this.
Correct.
And if it's every other meeting, then that's a problem.
Right.
You know, then you've got a schedule that's.
Yeah, well, we'll change the schedule or something.
You know, fouled up.
Right.
But,
or I'll have to.
Also, because maybe I'm restating what you just said, is it possible that there's a warrant that needs to be signed by the school committee as well?
Yes, but I do sign warrants every time I meet, but I can also go in to the superintendent's office to sign if needed. So.
Sure. Okay.
We can. We'll
figure it out.
Yeah. Not a big deal. We'll figure out something.
Great.
Maybe Doug can figure out how many conflicts there really are.
Yeah, I'll get the schedule.
We'll see.
There may not be many.
Because we change the meeting dates sometimes anyway.
Okay.
Like I said, the 18th we had changed because of the annual meeting, and then they postponed it, so. It turned out there was more people that had conflicts than just me.
Okay.
Doug, what do you want to do about the request to administrator by the select board? Do you want to go over that?
Well, actually, if I can, I'd like to backtrack a couple steps here.
Sure.
Meetings of the committee chairs. Oh, I'm sorry. You kind of already spoke to that. Okay. Leave that there.
That's a good idea. We need to do that in the next month or so.
Yep. I do want to advise that we've already been approached by folks from the Council of Governments. I'm trying to remember his name, and I can't off the top of my head, and forgive me. But we have a consultant who is ready and able to work with us to start working on long-term financial policies. This is something that the town identified as a criteria, as something important related to the Community Compact program that the governor has put out. We declared that as a priority for the town and something we wanted to work on. And as a result, we are now eligible for essentially professional assistance in helping to develop financial policies. That person, Joe Markarian is his name, finally rattled it loose, was waiting until the elections and until the board sat for the first time, but he's very interested in actually getting going. This is something which I hope could be done with members from this board or one member from this board, but also folks from the Finance Committee, folks from the CIPC, probably our treasurer and or accountant, possibly someone from perhaps our assessor's clerk or someone from the assessor's board, basically a cross-section of people serving in various town levels to help develop long-term policies. These are these 30,000-foot rules that help to determine other actions that all boards and committees take in building budgets, in determining priorities when it comes to expenditures, and so on and so forth. It would also help to determine free cash use policies, capital investment policies, OPEB management policies, and down the line. This would be a fairly thin policy book, 10, 12 pages, that would be the end result, but it would be a master document that all other smaller level or more specific policies would draw from.
And this person comes to us through the FERCOG?
Through the FERCOG at no cost to the town. The FERCOG is managing the expense to that as part of a grant that came from the state. And it seems to make a great deal of sense to take advantage of this, to explore this as an option, because I don't have enough fingers and toes to tell you how many times that I heard from the Finance Committee members, from the CIPC members, from members on this board, from people in town departments. We need financial policies. We need to establish rules for how we manage our short and long-term financial goals. So
great idea.
I'd like to, you know, get the okay from this board to be able to move forward with that.
Can you let him know that we are already actually meeting the Capital Improvement Committee is already starting work on May 25th.
Sure. That's the so CIPC that, is one car of the train.
I know.
But we're talking about actually, laying the track.
Right. But we are actually starting work.
Sure.
And that it would be helpful to have him participate in it. So whatever we're doing,
sure,
we're doing it within the framework that mm-hmm. is good practices or good guidance or whatever.
Sure. Okay. Okay. Well, then I can get back in touch with him tomorrow, and we can start setting up preliminary meetings.
Yeah.
And at the very least, there's a few folks that I know that are interested in this, and I can reach out to see if they'd be willing to start talking about it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
In the larger binder, which, by the way, I hope you take home and use as a reference, there's a number of things I wanted to point out to you. One of the first things is a bright, colorful chart. Mm-hmm. There are actually two or three versions of this chart, but and this is not comprehensive or complete, but I wanted to point it out to you. It's an organizational chart of the town's public elected and appointed boards and committees. It should be right at the front, and it folds out. Yep, there you go. The select board is at the top of the tree, but it's only one section of the tree, if you notice.
Mm-hmm.
The other elected boards are in bright yellow. The boards that are in orange are boards and committees that are appointed by multiple agents in town. And there's at least two boards down on the lower left, the purple boxes, that are boards or committees that are multi-town appointed boards, mm-hmm. The two boards of oversight, essentially. This is meant to provide you with a sense as to the structure of Deerfield. Government and management. It's intended to provide you with a sense of the various committees that are currently sitting or that are at least delineated, and to provide you with some sense of where to go or the resources that you have to draw from. I think shortly after this chart in your book is a list of contacts of all of the chairs. I'm watching Trevor folds pages, or is it at the very back? Is it all the way at the back, maybe? The contact list. Oh, I don't know if we have that.
It might be all the way in the back.
If it's not in the book, it'll be in addition to the book. That's why we can open these three-ring binders and add more things. We're going to provide you with a contact list of every chair of every committee, including cell phone numbers if they were provided to us. That's confidential information because it's, you know, basically, yep. That's the rule.
Yep.
We will not, by the way, give out your personal contact information to anyone unless you expressly authorize it for a specific person. This office will take messages for you and relay them to you along with contact info of whomever is trying to reach you. So you can return that contact should you wish, or you can respond through the office if you want to just provide a more general response. But your information, your home information, your phone number, that's confidential. We don't give that out. We don't give out your email address, that sort of thing. But we'll get that contact list to you. You should have the ability to reach out to any chair of any committee or board or commission at any given time. You should have the opportunity to reach out to department heads. I would strongly encourage you to not reach out to employees in given departments. Don't talk to a administrative assistant saying, hey, I really think you should. Talk to that person's department head and ask them to direct the administrative assistant to do something. That way, not only is there multiple notifications of the thing which you need to have done, but also the department head is able to work that into the workload for that person. It's maintaining, I hate to use the term chain of command, but it is maintaining that communication chain, if you will, and helping to make sure that the departments run as efficiently as possible. Does that make sense? I hope.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Okay. And you'll find that every single department head is ready and willing at any given time to bend over backwards to help you out. When it comes to the major departments, if there's issues, please also feel free to contact them through me or to contact them and include me on the email or what have you. I like to be kept informed because a request made to a department head may have other impacts, you know, further down the line. So that's also something to keep in mind. Of course, if there's an emergency or something urgent, get right in touch with whomever you need to and get it done. And we'll worry about the fallout later on. Okay. Sorry, Kevin. Thank you, Kevin. Appreciate that. When it comes to the sorry, and I'm on a rant, and I apologize, but they figure this is part of it, right?
Oh, no, it's fine. Okay. I was, when you said that Kevin made a comment.
Kevin probably, made it funny. Kevin just, yeah, never mind. Thank
he knows
you.
I harass
He's watching.
Him.
He's at home.
He knows I harass him about record keeping.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. Very good.
Well, we have to document anything that he does. We got to document it for.
Well, absolutely. Yeah.
Poor thing. He hears that daily. I know.
One thing, and we spoke about this very, very briefly about the concept of open meeting law and about we sort of touched on it in a sideways kind of way. I would request that the board, as Carolyn mentioned, you're going to have focuses that you might have. You might be working on a specific target or a specific task or looking at a specific area of town, and that's great. That's fantastic. And each of you will come up with a specialty or an area of interest that you want. When it comes to focusing on those things, please consider this office a resource. We want to be able to provide you with the information that you can use, that you can, you know, take advantage of, and that'll help you better do your job. I will suggest that if you come to me and say, I've got a new project, I'd like you to start doing X, Y, Z, I will throw it back at you and say, why don't we put that on the agenda for your next meeting so the board can talk about it and make a decision about whether or not to pursue that.
Right.
If it's an established project, great, we'll be happy to help you. If the board is doing this and you're going slightly to the left of that, but you're still going in that direction, we'll work with you. But if you're going off at a different direction that's never been talked about, or that's in contradiction to something that the board has decided, I'm going to ask that it come back before the board to be discussed, just to keep everybody on the same plane, to make sure everybody's on the same plate.
It is really awkward that we have no opportunity to talk about anything except on TV and, you know, but if there is something that you want, just go through Doug and Doug can pull us individually, and that's not a open meeting violation. If it's related to scheduling or something like that, but if we need an action, we have to have that in a public meeting.
This is
and
where.
So it's really hard because sometimes if you're making just ideas and you're just talking about stuff, you know, people, they only hear one part and it was just, you're just throwing it out there and it, you know, people freak out, but there's no other way to do it. We don't have any other opportunity. So if we're just talking about how we're going to deal with something or whatever, you know, there's no other way to do it. But what we do is have off meetings. If there is something that needs single issue meetings, a lot of times we would have like a Friday afternoon, or, you know, if we need to do a site visit or whatever, Doug can post that and put that on the agenda and we can go actually do a visit, or we can discuss just that one item. So we have the opportunity to do that anyway.
Okay.
And not on a regularly scheduled meeting, because sometimes if you're talking about something, it might take a couple hours to discuss stuff, and then it's like 11 o'clock at night. So having an off, if it's a serious enough topic, it's worth having an off schedule meeting, and we just work around our schedule, and we just need the 48 hours to set it up. And
you can do, like, I'll use the school roof as an example. Let's say there's ongoing, you know, the work is happening on the school roof and it's midsummer, and on a Wednesday evening you're talking about something and you say, hey, there's something I'm concerned with, we want to look at it. You can set up a site visit. You can set up an information gathering session. A visit to a site or a site visit to a project is outside of the strictures of open meeting law, so long as what you're doing is going there to gather information and not deliberating on the subject.
Right.
So we, you know, if Wednesday night you decide we're going to go look at this roof tomorrow morning, we're all free, great, go. Fantastic. And then we'll set up a meeting. We can even set up a meeting on a Saturday. I believe that's legal. So we could post a Saturday meeting to talk about it, but you could visit the site on Thursday, talk to the people who are there, get information, ask questions, as long as when you were done at the site visit, you simply parted ways and went elsewhere and talked about it at a regular meeting. That is legal. That's allowed.
And that's for more than one person, but Kip could go to the school and gather information by himself, bring it back to the board.
And he can pass it to Doug, and Doug can relay the information to us.
Sure.
As long as we're not making a decision, it's not a violation.
Yep. Okay.
Yep. The Finance Committee actually did this in spades this year, and I'm going to give them kudos for doing that, where the chair basically broke down a lot of different tasks, and individual members sought out information on a given topic. They went, they found the information, did the research, did the background, did the interviews, what have you, and brought that information back to a meeting so that everybody would benefit from that information. And that's a terrific use of folks' time. It allows you to multitask, parallel task, and then to be able to get that information to make the decisions.
And that's what John's doing on the Capital Improvement Committee. He's meeting with all the chairs and gathering information to bring us to the meeting so we have a little bit more current information.
Great.
So however we do it, we just can't deliberate at all.
Sure.
And it's just easier if we never phone call or never email and go through Doug and just decide that we're going to get together. You just have to decide 48 hours ahead of time so Doug can post it. And then we can get together.
Okay.
I'm moving down on the list. I wanted to remind you, of course, that you as the select board have the authority to appoint to several committees. Some of them are committees where you are the sole appointing authority. Others are committees where you share appointing authority with other agents, whether it be the town moderator or the planning board or so on and so forth. Those are outlined in that organizational chart. Basically, all of the green boxes across the top on the right-hand side, those are committees where you have sole appointing authority, I believe that's pretty much all of them. The orange boxes, you share appointing authority with other town agencies, and the two boards of oversight, of course, you appoint individual members to that. You don't have to make, as we've said, you don't have to make appointments before June 30th, but we'd like to get that sort of wrapped up, usually before June 1st. It's a good idea to have that together. We are working on providing you with a list of who's in what committees and who is in what offices so that you can, so you know whose terms last for how long. And the one other thing I would like to point out is those boards and committees that I think are highlighted in the orange in the middle, those are committees that, or boards or commissions, that have their duties outlined in the bylaws of the town. You basically provide members, they have jobs that they do.
I don't want to speak out of turn, but is the Open Space Committee still functional? Because I've been watching. I haven't seen a meeting in quite some time.
It does have members. I do not know that it's met. That being said, and is that one of the joint appointees? I think it's three members from the board and two members from the moderator are appointed?
Yes, correct.
Okay.
They updated their open space plan, Kippy, but then they didn't, they haven't had any parcels come before them. They're supposed to recommend to us parcels, that are being preserved or anything that we're doing. And actually, we did request a planning board review of the parcels that we were interested in selling, but you know what? We never went to the Open Space Committee, and Lynn Rose pointed that out, so we do need to run stuff by her.
Sure.
Her committee.
The other thing I did want to point out to you is those committees that are highlighted in green at the upper right. Those committees are committees that you appoint. Their duties are not necessarily outlined in the bylaws. And you, as appointing authority, have the authority to charge those committees to do certain things that are within the scope of their focus. You can choose to say, we would like you to look at this project and give us a recommendation by such a date. I would strongly encourage you to consider that as you make appointments to these committees. Having committees work nebulously or under their own steam is like having, you know, seven or eight dogs pulling the sled, but all of them are going in different directions, and you're sitting there, you know, yelling mush, and the sled's not moving. If you coordinate the work of these multiple committees with a broader or higher goal in mind, then I think everyone can be a little bit more successful. And so I would encourage you to look at that. I would also encourage you to look at the charges that are detailed by the bylaws for those other multi-appointment boards and committees and commissions. They're in the bylaws. They're listed there. I strongly encourage you to become familiar with them and to understand what their scope of responsibility is.
One of the issues is when I'm on the planning board is when the school roof project came up, you know, my board, I don't want to speak for them, but we weren't notified of it. Mm-hmm. And I heard of it, and I went out on my own and did investigating work. I kind of think that it would be a good idea just to let the planning board know of pending, you know, municipal projects. Whether we get any feedback from them or not, I don't know, but you know, as long as I'm there, you know, I'll give my input. Mm-hmm. I could give
it's
it
It's not
here
just
anyways,
a good idea. It's the bylaw. It's in the bylaws. It says that all large capital projects shall go before the planning board for review and comment, as well as to the CIPC. Acquisition or disposition of lands goes before the open space committee.
Which we didn't do.
But we still can.
I know. We need
absolutely
to do
still
that.
Can.
No, I know.
I heard that at town meeting, and that's why I asked about this, because since I haven't seen any regular meetings, I didn't know how do you deal with that. If they don't have regular meetings, well, do they just call it on need?
Yeah. So, well, if they have a specific task, then they do meet to do that specific task. But the review of any parcels and stuff like that, we would ask them to meet to review. We asked the planning board for input, but we neglected not to do the, you know, neglected the open space committee. And so that has, you know, we need to do that.
Okay. There's also a number of things.
That was just an oversight.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't intentional.
Yeah. The open space committee does have that authority, that responsibility. But the open space committee, there's at least two separate things in my mind that they would be helpful in advising on. One is the fact recently we were notified that the Franklin Land Trust is looking at helping landowners put certain pieces of land into Chapter 61A protection. The Open Space Committee could be an interface between the town and the land trust to talk about their longer-term plans, their longer-term goals, and maybe there was ways that they could help to coordinate and you know, respond to those concerns. The Open Space Committee should be aware of what's going on with the Recreation Department. The Open Space Committee should be aware of expectations to do renovations on open space, even small open space like the South Deerfield Town Common. Technically, that qualifies.
Looking at the bigger picture, how do you get to coordinate all of this so it doesn't, you know, something comes before this board and then it has to go before the planning board and go before the open space? And it just tends to stretch out this whole process, and it makes it very cumbersome for anybody involved with it, you know?
It is tough to coordinate. I'll bring you back to the two tools you have at your disposal. One is the administrator's office. You have people to work for you to help you do these things. If the board says, put this before the planning board or the open space committee, that's what we'll do. Okay. The other tool you have at your disposal is to give them a deadline.
Yeah.
Put this before these two committees, ask them to report to us by such a date, and if we don't get a report, we will assume you have no problem with it and we're moving forward.
Oh, that's good.
You know, and those are tools you have at your discretion. So, timelines. That's the last thing I'll just talk about, and I'll speak from my own personal experience. I have learned a great deal about the importance of timelines, particularly through the budget process, but also through the process of trying to get capital items on a schedule, trying to back into a meeting date, a town meeting date, and plan everything so that everything falls into place to land on that town meeting date at the right time and everything together. That is something I'm going to continue to focus on. I'm going to be looking very hard at the bylaws to determine exactly what we need to do and how we need to do it and in what order. And I will work as best as I can with you to make sure that you are working on a timeline that works for the greater good of Deerfield. The next timeline is town meeting April 2017. We're already on that timeline. We're already starting. The CIPC is working on the five-year plan. Granted, that's to get us, you know, to backtrack into our FY17 expenses, but they're also building the five-year plan that we're going to use as a stepping stone for FY18. I'm going to be working, hopefully, with Finance Committee and assessors and so on and so forth to start talking about revenue expectations for FY18. That's part of the first step in the timeline. I'll leave it at that. That binder that you have, the heavier, bigger binder, there are a number of other things in there. There's some additional information. We've included a full copy of the bylaws of the town of Deerfield as they exist right now.
Thank you.
It's a static copy. I strongly encourage you to become aware of the e-code site, which is available through our website for our bylaws. That is the most up-to-date version. I know that there's a lot of discussion about reviewing these bylaws. John Pereski talked about it earlier tonight, looking at the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, or Capital Improvement Plan Committee, is the right term, about the bylaw that governs their operation. You can, as a board, request their recommendations for changes to their own rules as codified in the bylaws. That would be a great way to look and see how can we make efficiencies, how can we create a better, cleaner operating system for the CIPC. We can do that with every single committee that has their work in the bylaws. You can also make changes as you see fit. I will very likely be making some suggestions, not to change the purpose of the bylaws, but to take things out that don't belong there, like fee schedules. They don't belong in the bylaws. Things that could change year to year should not be in the bylaws. And we'll be looking at that over the next few months. You also have in this binder a few other things. One is a guide to small town administration. I think that's published by the Mass Municipal Association from some years back. There is, what else do we have in there?
We have a guide on, we have a guide on town meetings, and we have a town administrator's position guide.
Right. That's a copy of a report that was published by the DOR back in 2013. It's called a review of the town administrator's, or a report on the town administrator's position, but the scope of the report, it goes beyond that. And it's I found it to be a valuable read, and it's certainly worth looking at. That's your binder. Take it home with you. Don't leave it on the table. The other binder that you've got, the smaller binder, generally, you're welcome to any and all the information that's in that. Take it with you if you want to keep it. Otherwise, we will simply take the information out and replace it with new information for your next meeting. Okay. I would finally like to suggest that maybe we might consider going to a paperless packet, which we have the technology to do. We could make a less than $1,000 purchase of a couple or three tablets, and you'd be able to bring that with you, have it wherever you need, and as we get new information, it would automatically appear as an item on your tablet, if that's something you'd like to do. If you'd prefer paper, that's great. But just want to throw that out there.
Some trees.
I'm sorry, I'm an old fart. I like paper, so I can highlight it.
I agree with Carolyn.
Okay.
I love this thing, but I still want to break it.
I know. Well.
So that's a big no. Trevor.
No, Trevor can do it.
Huh?
No, Trevor, you can do it. It's easier for, I retain stuff if I highlight it.
Yeah.
And as I read it.
Right for a while.
Whereas if I read it off the computer, it's like, yeah. I lose. I can't retain it.
Yep.
It's really weird. It's a physical thing.
I hear you. Yeah.
One last thing is that everything that's in that binder, broadly speaking, is a printout from a digital scan, so we have the files available digitally, and every item that's in that binder is a public document.
Right. So anything in this, I'll just take it out and
please
leave the
folder.
I'll leave the folder here, but
yep.
I'll just
yep. The tan divider or the divider pages, leave those. Leave the tabs. Everything else, take as you feel see fit. That's your information.
The next item on the agenda, Doug, you have the Wastewater Treatment Study Committee.
Yeah, I'm looking for direction on that.
Well, we were taking names.
Yep.
And I think we actually have, how many names do we have?
There's at least six or seven people that are on that.
Okay, so I guess I would like to just announce that we would like to appoint that committee the next meeting, and that anybody else that's interested to put their hat into the ring and
I would like to request that Kevin Scarborough and myself be ex officio non-voting members of that committee, purely as facilitators of information. I know that Kevin has about 4, 5, 6 agendas already in his mind in terms of what the committee will need to become familiar with, information that they're going to need to be able to really understand the system as it exists. And I know that he's working with Keith Milne, our chief wastewater treatment plant operator, to also put together some information and possibly to arrange for tours of not only each plant, but also the other facilities that feed into the wastewater system. So the expectation is that the committee is going to go on some field trips, going to really get a sense as to what it's all about and what the equipment does, the condition of the current facilities, get an understanding as to what an operator does, which I think it's fascinating, actually. And the amount of pressure they're under. You're driving a train that does not stop, and you better be able to do it right and have 6 contingencies in place if something goes wrong.
And you are handling hazardous materials.
You are handling hazardous, yeah,
we
absolutely.
And there's regulatory penalties if we don't do things correctly.
Big time.
Yeah.
Big time.
So there, it is very important that we get that.
It is important that we do it, but I do know on a regular basis that millions of gallons of raw sewage are dumped into the Connecticut River by some of the bigger cities up and down the valley.
Not on a regular basis. Not Deerfield.
Not Deerfield. I'm saying other towns downstream, but
yeah,
it's amazing, you know, because the bottom line, if there's a problem, then they can't plug the sewer system, so it just goes.
Absolutely.
Well, but they get fined. I mean, they're not allowed to do that anymore. I mean, there is oversight, Kippy.
Yeah.
There is oversight.
There are cases. I'd be willing to bet that Irene was one of those cases where there were variances that were permitted because of the
Greenfield was dumping in 2 million gallons a day.
Yeah,
because after Irene into the Green River that went into the Deerfield that went into the Connecticut.
Yep.
And it was tracked. I mean, there's not much you can do when you have these events.
Right. Sure.
There is some, but in general, you're not allowed to do that.
I understand that.
Right.
The only other committee I'd like us to see form this year, only because I would like us to pursue some grants, since we did adopt the policies that you put together, is the Complete Streets. We are, because you adopted the Complete Streets policy, Doug made up a generic policy,
yep.
So and we adopted a select board. So we are actually in a position to put in for grants, and there's been so much work in the common this year, and it was so nice, and I just would like to see more work done. And we did have that Complete Streets, that some of those things that Kevin could be doing, and we could try to get the state to do some of them, because, you know, that is a state highway,
sure,
somewhat. So we can coordinate with the state. Maybe we can pressure the state to do some stuff, and Kevin could do a little bit in his when he's doing his planning. And I'd like to get our sidewalks replaced, have a plan for sidewalk replacement. We've been talking about that for years and years, and so many people walk our sidewalks, and we have a really walkable South Deerfield is really walkable, and so part of the whole thing of walkability and sociability is having safe access, and so I think we could get a grant so we could get our sidewalks ADA, which is your access ability, get them access compliant, and then just make them safer and more enjoyable for families and elders, because one of the issues is, you know, they're in, some of the places are in pretty rough shape, so they're trip hazards and stuff like that, and we want to encourage people to get out and walk, so it would be lovely if we had the ability to have a committee. So I guess I'd really like us to advertise for a Complete Streets committee that, I mean, there are some people that are very interested in that, and we have some downtown businesses that might want to participate.
Okay. So a Complete Streets committee to examine
We want them to get together so that we can start doing the work for application for a grant.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're in a position to get grants. So what I'm trying to do is to have you have a resource, Doug, because obviously when I say write a grant if I'm not doing it myself, then who else is? It's you. So I was hoping that this committee would be a resource for you, so you're not solely responsible for doing the grant.
Is it than just the sidewalks that you're interested in?
Well, we had the whole complete streets.
I did read through it, but I found it very conflicting. Because on some parts of it, they wanted crosswalks in one location, then they would change it, then they wanted to change the direction of one street, then close it right off. It just seemed to be a lot of different ideas.
Yeah, and that's what the committee would do, would be to set priorities. I mean,
sift through those ideas.
Yeah. I mean, the sidewalks has been an issue for years. So
the reason I was asking, Carolyn, is a sidewalk something you can apply for a grant for and just move on the sidewalks themselves?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Accepting the complete streets policy and by committing to the complete streets priority in our community compact, what we've basically done is stated that as we renovate, as we revise, as we change, as we rebuild our transportation infrastructure, our sidewalks, our roads, our streets, that we will be using complete streets methodology in our designs. And that basically means working to develop multi-modes of transportation where bicycles, walkers, automobiles, folks who need wheelchairs to get around are all taken into consideration as the design of the street or the sidewalk is put together. That being said, correct me if I'm wrong, we are looking at taking some of the results from that complete streets study.
Yep.
That was done more recently, and the one that was done before that, and I think the one that was done way before that.
We have several.
Taking some of those ideas, looking at all of them, and having the committee basically come up with one idea for implementation in any given area. At this intersection, we say we want to do this type of sidewalk, this type of bump out, and maintain this kind of flow of traffic,
right?
For example. Mm-hmm. Before we can apply for a grant, we need to have a plan that's in place.
Well, my point to all that is that it seemed to be there was so much, so comprehensive that it was overwhelming, and that you're mm-hmm. going to get difference of opinions on this, that, or the other thing, where if mm-hmm. you can single things out that you know are of most importance and get those done, that would be.
Well, that's why I picked the sidewalks, because, yeah. I mean, over the years, the sidewalks have been multiple complaints, and
yes.
yeah. we've tried to do patchwork, but to do really good sidewalks is very expensive. But if we had a grant, then sure. we could, you know, either do it ourselves or have it contracted out, and it would be lovely to have. I mean, the walkability of our streets would be huge. So, that seems like I only suggest that. That does not mean that we have to, that would be the priority, but it would be nice if we had a committee and would put together the reasoning, at least a section of a sidewalk. They could go out and decide that this is the worst section and this is the section that would be the highest priority to replace, that kind of thing.
Start first.
And it would be helpful because then we can write it up as, you know, as a community group has done this. And,
yes.
you know, and this, you know, over the years, this is X number of people walk here it's, you know, you're trying to get people to be mobile, and that's the number one public health goal is to get people out and walking. So, you know, we could apply for,
yes.
You make your story so you're incorporating public health. And we have seniors that walk up and down the street because the senior center is right here. So this is why we want to do this section. And, you know, you make your story and
sure.
justify the grant. And hopefully this group would be able to do the legwork to either put it together or to help Doug put it together to submit, you know.
Okay.
And they would do a little bit of research of what, you know, what's the best angle, what's the best chance of having, you know, us get this grant. But if we're never applying, we're never going to get it. And that's why I didn't want us to skip over a complete streets thing.
Sure.
Because we've been meaning to do that.
Okay. What I can do is promote the idea, the Complete Streets Study Committee, and get it out on the website, talk about it as much as possible, and see if we can have some folks who are interested in working on that.
Mm-hmm. We might have some seniors that, you know, walk and know that sidewalks are in pretty rough shape, and mm-hmm. they would know where mm-hmm. to where they should focus in on, or something like that.
Sure, sure.
We certainly have enough complaints to know where the generally the bad areas are, but it would be nice if, you know, people that are walking up and downtown currently would sure. be willing to participate.
If this tends to drag out to be, you know, like toward the end of June, and it doesn't seem like it's coming together too quickly, do you or Doug know of the area to apply for grants for the sidewalks?
There's actually a number of grants that we could apply for, at least for design services directly from the state. That's part of the Community Compact program, is that there's, I think, up to $20,000 available, grants of up to $20,000 available for design services. The steps that we've taken up to this point have enabled us to qualify for those. And if we have an intention for the use of those funds, if we say, here's what we're going to do, we're going to design boom, 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 in this location, then we could qualify for a design grant.
But why even bother? Why not just skip that? Why hire somebody to design a sidewalk?
Because by getting a completed design, a shovel-ready design, yeah. we'll then qualify for grants of up to $1.5 million for the construction. But the state wants to see the design, a shovel-ready design.
So part of the grant process would have to show a design prior?
Correct.
And that's why you'd have a committee, so that you can discuss what area you want them to focus in on. And
the committee would also manage the public information,
yeah.
doing the public hearings, soliciting input from folks, both in the neighborhoods as well as in the town as a whole, and then present draft design one, get feedback, draft design two, get feedback, and then a final design and get feedback, all at public hearings that are promoted and advertised, so that by the time you're finished, you've got a design that not only is solid and makes sense logistically or construction in terms of its construction, but also that the public is aware of and has bought into. So then when you're ready to put a shovel in the ground, you're building. There aren't questions about it.
And that way you've met your public procurement requirements by having the design, because the state just doesn't give you money for implementation. You have to
would
show
these
that
grants, are they, you know, a total grant or a matching funds grant?
The design grants are just straight grants.
Yeah. And that's part of our community compact. This is, I don't know, Kippy, do you remember, were you on the planning board when it was Commonwealth Capital?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, in Mitt Romney's day, it was Commonwealth Capital when I was on the planning board. And we jumped through the hoops. We figured out all the stuff. I went up to the FERCOG, and we got one of the highest scores in the state. And it really actually paid off, because it gave us, I don't know, we had three or four different grants, plus we had low percentage on any of our open space APR money. And so that was a huge deal. And then more and more communities got on board, and everybody ended up with scores, and it got diluted, and then Mitt Romney went away, and it died. And so this community compact is very similar to the Commonwealth Capital. You have all these hoops to jump through, and we had to decide what we were going to do. So we jumped through the hoops, we signed up, and what is happening is a community, if you're going to get any grants or get any money from the states, you get a score, and it shows you what you're actually doing. So by doing our stuff that we're going to do anyway, like our develop finance policies and develop, you know, like complete streetscape kind of thing is one of our listed projects. By actually having the committee doing complying for the design, it gives us points, so that if we wanted to apply for the sewer treatment plant Mass Works project, they would look at our score and they would say, okay, you've jumped through this hoop, and you've got a community compact score of 92. So then you're going to be eligible for that pool of money for the Mass Works grant. So in some ways, you don't have a choice. The best thing to do is just do this stuff anyway, because it gives us a higher score and positions us for eligibility for something that really counts, like a multi-million-dollar Mass Works project for the sewer treatment plant. But in reality, we're really doing stuff that we wanted to do anyway, and that's why we were so careful as Select Board. We were picking what we wanted to do, because some of this stuff is what we were going to do anyway. So why wouldn't you do that?
I can't say exactly, but it just from this small conversation, it kind of sounds like the sidewalk project could go down the same road as the school roof, where you get involved with all this design and the expense goes up. I mean, building sidewalks is also a very simple thing, you know. But it can become a complicated mess once you get more engineers and people inside.
Well, if you want the state to pay, and I agree 100%, Skippy. I mean, Kippy. Skippy was my son-in-law. If I agree 100%. If Kevin was going to do it, we wouldn't do this. But if we're going to apply for state money, for the state to pay for it, then we
have
to.
That's why I asked if the state would pay for all of it or a portion. And their portion might not be as inexpensive as if we did it ourselves, you know.
Oh, absolutely. And that's one of the things we'd look at. But as far as I know, the grants, the works, the complete street stuff is usually in-kind contribution only, right?
I do not know the details of the construction grants. I know that the design grants are just a straight grant.
Yeah.
There's no matching contribution required. That's as far as I've gotten.
That'd be interesting because we could continue this conversation. I mean, if I didn't bring my slide rule, but I could tell you exactly how much it costs to go 1,000 feet. You know, and it's real simple, but
Oh, well, I know. But there's all kinds of requirements on these state things.
If you go through a state, right.
Yeah.
Right.
But it also gives us points, and we always have to look at that. You know, are we getting, we're getting points towards wastewater treatment grant? And that's, I mean, that's one of the things.
It is true. I kind of get involved with what you're talking about when the town adopted the green energy, you call the
green communities.
The green communities, the stretch energy code, and that, in a way, they calculate the score of the home when it's completed is by a point system. And one of the things that's very frustrating is if you put an electric hybrid water heater in, the state thinks electricity is a cleaner energy, so they give you more points, even though it consumes more energy than propane gas. And it seems like such a backwards way of going, but because that's their gig at the time, they're giving you points just to push you to do that, and it's foolish. But
I know, I'm not disagreeing, Kippy. I'm.
I know it seems frustrating.
It is, and you just ultimately, well, you'll get familiar with the Chapter 30B, and if you can beat Chapter 30B, I will be thrilled to death.
We may have found our man.
Yeah, I know. It's.
I have about three things that'll take about 2 minutes. I would like to get your signatures on this. There's actually two copies. This is a blank form for our tag sale permit. This is one of those things that's officially a permit given by the Board of Selectmen, but it's really just managed through our office, and it's a permit that's granted upon request of a resident. We like to have a copy with everybody's signatures on it, so we will then photocopy that and fill in the name of the resident as they come in to apply for the permit. I will also hand a copy of this for every one of you. I will keep one for myself so I can talk about it. This is a formal invitation from Darius Modesto, who's the principal of Frontier Regional School, inviting you to the 59th graduation, which will be held on June 3rd, 7 o'clock, in the football field at Frontier Regional High School. You're also invited to attend class night, which is Wednesday, June 1st, 7 o'clock, in the Frontier Regional School auditorium. This is a great opportunity to get out there and show the support of the Board of Selectmen.
That's really nice.
And finally, the last thing I have to hand around, I would love to have your signatures on it. It even shows where you're supposed to be signing it. I've got a couple of copies of it. This is a proclamation which the board essentially voted to approve. Let me just make sure. I'll hold on to one copy so I can read from it. This is a proclamation of the board, I think, that was voted previously, given to the Deerfield Lions Club, celebrating their 70th anniversary, and also proclaiming May 18th, 2016 as Deerfield Lions Day in the town of Deerfield. And it's pretty self-explanatory. I plan to be present on May 18. To make sure that this gets handed over. It is a dinner that's being held. If one of you would rather attend, I'm very happy to make that arrangement. and to present this. We'll put this in a nice frame or in a binder or what have you, and it can be presented at that time. Ceremonial, purely.
Thank you, Doug.
And I think that's all I have.
Do I sign both or just one?
Yeah.
You can just sign
one. Just sign one,
make sure everybody gets it. Although, you know what? Sign both because sure. I want to have a backup just in case something happens to the first.
Actually, Doug, we have to do the animal control contract.
Correct. There is... oh, boy, do I have that?
Okay. Well, I don't want to say I'm... John Pachorik is in charge of the animal control officer, but I'm the one on the committee. And this has been really working out, and we voted the budget for this next year. So this is actually... is this a three-year one or is this a one-year one? Oh, no, this is a three-year one. We upped it. It has been working out so well. No, we decided contract. That we would do a three-year contract, back and that way the costs are the same for the 3 years. So
agreement between three communities?
Yes. We work. Greenfield is the lead community and takes 50% of the time, and Montague and Deerfield split the 25% of the time. In reality, we actually get more than 25% of the time, but we don't advertise that too much because we only pay for 25%.
We're working on getting a copy of that contract for you to sign, if you so choose.
Yes.
I would like to advise that that contract came in about $400 higher than the appropriation the town meeting just voted.
Oh, did it?
It did. It also doesn't represent the whole amount of money that we need for animal control services. There's another $800 or so that will be going to the Franklin Sheriff's Office dog shelter.
That's under another line item.
It is?
Yes, because that is a separate agreement with the Sheriff's Office for the kennel.
Yeah.
So that actually is not under that animal control line item. I'm trying to think what line item it is. It might be under our Board of Health.
Okay, fair
enough.
I'll
have to look.
I've been advised.
It's actually voted as not $800. It's somewhere $800.
Okay. I've been advised by the town accountant to just simply sign the contract for such a small amount of money and then come in the spring, early summer, or sorry, in spring, late spring, in 2017, we'll go to get a transfer from another account as need be to backfill that extra.
I wonder why that, how did we?
Binder.
Okay.
How did we get to $400? Was that a typo on our part?
Yes, that's exactly it. I'm sorry?
Was that a typo on our part?
Because no, it was not. We received a draft budget.
We put the draft in and not the final budget.
But we just got this final budget literally on the 28th of April.
Okay.
So there was no way to get to it. This is a clean copy of that contract. Check the last page of that, if you would, Trevor, to find out. Does it need one signature from the board or multiples?
There's three spots.
There you go. So multiples. Each of you.
I make a motion to approve the contract as presented.
I second it.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
I have to say our animal control officer, Colleen, is so fantastic. He really does a good job. And one of the things that we used to have to do as Board of Health is go chase down bats, and I am so thrilled that we have no more bat duties. And we're not deputy dog officers anymore. That used to be one of our other jobs.
Well, and Tondra, if I've ever heard
so,
one.
I know firsthand, Colin bat does duty. Do a very good job.
He's excellent. And so anyway, thank you.
The very last thing I have, you can choose to act on this tonight or not. It's up to you. We received a letter out of the blue of interest in an appointment to the Personnel Board. Karen Morrow wrote, and you have a copy of her letter, basically expressing interest in becoming a member of the Personnel Board and is willing to serve in that capacity. We've prepared an appointment form that will expire on June 30th of this year, so it would be a short-term appointment. And then you can reappoint her when we do all the rest of the appointments.
We have a vacancy, is that correct?
What's that?
We have a vacancy, is that correct?
Yes, we do.
Okay. I make a motion we appoint her for the
I'll second the motion.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Would you please thank her for putting in the letter of interest?
That Absolutely.
Was, that was very nice. Doug, it would be very helpful if you and Kat could organize what vacancies we do have so that we can really try to recruit between now and June 30th.
Oh, it will be done.
Okay.
I'm going to pass that appointment form, sign anywhere above where it says Select Board in the bottom right quadrant.
Anywhere above it?
Anywhere above it. Yep. Yeah, and that empty space there looks great. That's it.
Okay.
That's all I've got. Thank you. Unless you wanted to bring up the town meeting question. No? Mm-hmm. Okay.
I forgot what it was.
Oh, related to the solar project.
No.
No.
We don't have any further information then, do anyway.
We were informed today, informally at least, by the chair of the Board of Assessors that the developer of the solar array, Lake Street Development Partners, as well as the Board of Assessors, have come to an agreement on a pilot schedule on a payment in lieu of taxes for that project. They have agreed on a schedule and an amount, and they will be getting that to you as soon as possible.
So would you...
thank you.
Sure.
So we need to schedule a special town meeting because obviously we want this to go forward as soon as possible and
Correct.
Collect our money. So...
yeah.
All right. So what's the town meeting schedule on this special town meeting? When do you...
Special town meeting, as soon as you open the warrant, put items on the warrant, and close the warrant and order it to be posted, it's about a three-week minimum turnaround to get the publication out, to get it posted, and to get it scheduled. It would happen here, so not at the high school, so there's no coordination of that schedule. I would say 3 weeks is the timeline.
Okay. Would you guys feel comfortable if we opened the warrant on our May 25th meeting?
It's fine with me.
And then we still could get this done before June 30th.
It would be done before June 30th, yes.
Yeah. So let's try to do that. We'll open the warrant on and close it on the 25th.
Okay.
Will
you be having a meeting on the 18th?
Do you want a meeting on the 18th? Do we have enough stuff to make it worthwhile having a meeting?
I'm wondering. I don't think we'll be able to prep appointments by then.
Let's just do it on the 25th.
Stick with the meeting on the 25th?
Do you want to just do it on the 18th, even if it was for a short amount of time? I wouldn't be bothered coming here for 20 minutes, and it would help move that process forward for those folks.
And you can also sign the warrant on that day anyways.
Oh, well, we have to sign the warrant. So let's go ahead. Let's do a short meeting. We'll put together an agenda for the 18th. I mean, we'll work on that.
Great.
And as long as nobody minds.
Okay.
So, okay. If there's nothing else, then we'll
Bruce,
have an...
Bruce
oh, Bruce, I'm sorry.
Just a comment. The packet that was passed out of town meeting, I think that was a terrific idea. That's the first time I've ever seen that, and made so much more sense than what has been passed out in the in past town meetings.
Well, I'm glad you liked it, Bruce.
I think a lot of people did, and especially the beginning where it gave a little bit of introduction to the bylaws, how the town meeting was presented. But the biggest thing was the anticipated wording, because what is normally there is just a general article. And when you as Select Board are reading that article's off with your wording, everybody's going trying to figure out what they're even talking about, because there's no rhyme or reason as what your motion is and what was being printed. So I think this was a great idea. Secondly, election day is, I stood out there for several hours in the afternoon, and for a change, I was really impressed and glad to see the number of younger voters that came to the polls, and especially with a no ballot question that was controversial. Usually, unless there's a controversial ballot question, the turnout is very low and it's a limited number of people. I hope that some of those younger people that came out to vote will start to take an interest in town government. I know short time I was involved in it as an assessor, does a great job, and I encourage anybody to come out and look for some of these other offices in the future.
Thank you, Bruce. Yeah, we're trying to recruit the younger generations. I know. You know, that's the problem. I mean, you just get tired. And, I you know, this with all the pipeline stuff that was going on, it's been, I mean, it's going to be nice to get back to regular town business. Because that has been, that was a huge.
It helped to bring out some of the younger people. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, no, there was. There was a lot of.
Good to see it.
Yeah, there was a lot of, I think there was a lot of community coming together because of the pipeline stuff, especially kept bouncing around. I mean, ultimately, it bounced on the other side of the power lines, and it was going through the Greenfield Golf Course and not the North Meadows, but it's still, you know, it started out below Clarkdale, and then it went up behind my house, and now it was behind the power lines, and who knows where ultimately it was going to be built. And actually, I wanted, thank you for reminding me of that, because I was going to thank Michelle, because we were going to get a meter station that had not more than once a day, but would have had a blow-off kind of thing. And Michelle was going to work, had volunteered. I had asked her if she would be willing to do this, and she had very nicely volunteered to coordinate our emergency dispensing site medical people and the UMass group, public health, school of public health, to do the baseline health surveys of all the people downwind from that. And then I had found out that we were going to get a compressor station at some point. You know, they had only, when they moved the pipeline to Northfield as the compressor station, that was the original 40-mile-apart one, but they were going to put one around 12 miles, and which would have been back into Deerfield, and we would have had, you know, other baselines of wherever they ended up doing that, whether it was Woman Hill or up in Shelburne Conway area, that would have been, Deerfield would have been downwind from. So it would have been an awful lot of work. And I just want to thank her for being willing to have taken that on, because that would have been the only thing that we would have had to, you know, force some kind of compliance and worry about health, is to do those baseline health surveys. And they were very detailed. They had to be done in a certain way that would hold up in court, and it was going to be a lot of work. So I want to make sure that she knew how much I appreciated her volunteering, and hopefully we'll not have to do that. But those issues were huge, and I think that brought a lot of people out, because there was a lot of young people that were concerned. Yeah. It was good. So we had a lot of conversation, but thank you for triggering my memory on that. I did want to thank Michelle for that. And I felt like maybe there's going to be more involvement, and I think that's good, because that's the only way we're going to be able to. I mean, that's, unfortunately, this is the old-fashioned volunteer kind of thing, and if we're going to have run town government, we have to have people participate. So anyway, thank you. Jeff, did you have anything to say? I know I've tapped you for some volunteering stuff too, so make sure we're going to start scheduling meetings.
It's good to see that more people get involved.
Yeah, yeah, really, I do. I agree 100%.
Happy to see, you know, it's, compared to what we've had previously, the town annual town meeting was a pretty good turnout. Mm-hmm. It would have been nice to see more people, but at least it was a start. Voting turnout was a good turnout compared to what we've had in the past. So it's good.
Well, I have.
Hopefully, as we go along here, more people become more aware of what's happening in Deerfield. And I think the key here is, how are we going to be able to sustain this if we, you know, if we're running revenue
fairly
consistent and not being able to grow that.
I know. Well, that's one of the reasons we're going to have this special town meeting, to get our solar money in quick. But I was truly very worried that when we went to that second night at town meeting, that we weren't going to get very many people. And we did have less people, but we still had enough people. I felt like there was a good show, which was a lot more than I anticipated anyway. So I was happy. But
still a lot less than it was when I first moved into town 12 years ago.
I know.
First couple of town meetings down there, if you weren't down there early, you couldn't sit, much less park.
Wow. I know.
Now it's kind of like, well, pick a place.
I know. Well, hopefully we'll do some interesting things and maybe that will draw more people to be interested in town stuff. You know, if we do, maybe if we do the complete streets and we talk about the wastewater treatment, that's going to be an impact money-wise, so people maybe will be more involved in that. And certainly that we're going to have a really interesting discussion about the schools because, as you do know, it's not sustainable. So we have to do something. And so let's do something exciting. Let's do something that is really going to improve the experience for our kids. And I think that will draw a lot of interest because, and with Trevor here, hopefully people will see this is not an anti-education move. This is, let's move on to the next step. Let's move on to the future versus, we're just, trying to
keep. For the whole town to figure out because as we can see what's happening, even with the property taxes, you're not going to be able to sustain that.
I know.
Force some people out of Deerfield. And so you're going to have to reach that balance. And it's not an easy thing to do. I mean, you only can grow your revenue so much, and you only can, as far as a total town budget, you only can control that so much too. So you've got to be able to try to match those, and be able to sustain it. And if you can't, I'm sorry to say, but we're going to see people having to leave Deerfield, and I hate to see that.
I mean,
it was just 6 months ago, or not even that, 3 months ago. When South County presented their ambulance service down there, and I had a 75-year-old lady sitting behind me, a nice lady, saying that she was going to have to sell her house and move in with her daughter because she couldn't afford the taxes. That's sad. And I hope people realize that. That's why I say, I hope, awareness. And somehow we, as a town, everybody involved can correct that.
Well, I, the more people that participate, the better end result is. And so I'm hoping, and with our new superintendent, hopefully Trevor can make inroads with, and we'll have someone, like a Marty Barrett to work with, and versus the other ones we've had in the past. So hopefully things will be positive. We have to, I feel like if everybody comes together and we work together, and we're all on the same page, and then we will end up with.
I think so. If people are willing to communicate.
Yeah,
it's the key.
That's the big thing. That's the key.
Yeah. So anyway, Doug, you want us to go into executive session for a moment?
Please, I am requesting an executive session for the purpose of pending litigation related to an appeal of a Zoning Board of Appeals decision.
Carolyn Ness, aye. Just state your name and then say.
Trevor McDaniel, aye.
Henry Camosa, aye.
You just voted on a motion that wasn't officially made.
Oh, well, I make that motion. I'm sorry. I thought you were making the motion. You read the motion.
I can't make a motion.
All right. So I make the motion. That's my motion, yes. And then somebody second it.
Second.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, and then Carolyn Ness, aye.
Trevor McDaniel, aye.
Henry Camosa, aye.
Thank you. And you leave executive session only to adjourn?
Yes. And the signing of the warrant.
Yep.
I think everyone, I don't know if you haven't had a chance to sign it, have you?
I have not signed
yet. Okay.
But I'll do that.
We'll adjourn with the signing of the warrant.
See you later, Jeff.
Very good.
See you later, Bruce.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you both
for
coming.
Thank you.